Say that again, because that is like your single job as an employee, right?
Yeah. Yeah. It's to make your boss look good.
What's shaking? Welcome back to the All In Podcast. I'm your host, Rick Jordan, and I have today a dude who 3 years ago really couldn't even tell you what it meant to be an entrepreneur because he was ridden with over 200K of debt. Imagine that. How much would 200K set you back today? Then in 2016, he booked a solo trip to Kenya, and that changed it all. Ryan Helms, what's shaking, my man? Welcome to the show.
What's up, Rick, man? Thanks so much for having me on. So ready to kind of dive into everything. And hopefully I can provide your audience some value today.
I'm sure you will, brother. I mean, just with that cliffhanger, I like that. You know, that trip changed it all. So let's dive into that, man. What your debt, right? 200K, right? How the heck did that happen to begin with?
I think it happens for a lot of people in the US and probably all over the world, really. It just kind of sneaks up on you. You get caught in this whole consumer culture where like you want to like keep up with the Joneses and have the coolest new stuff that comes out. And before I knew it, I went on that trip and I met all these people that were traveling the world. And I was like, man, that would be super cool to do. Like, I would love to do that one day. And then I was like, on the flight home, I had to address like the big elephant in the room, like, how the hell would I finance that? And that's when I really started, because I'd kind of like put my head in the sand when it came to like my finances. I was like, I knew I had enough to eat and really do what I wanted to do. I didn't need to check my bank account to see if I needed to do anything. But once I actually like looked at the numbers, I was like, crap, like I'm dependent on my job. Like I'm dependent on that check coming every month, where I wasn't paycheck to paycheck, but I still needed that. Like I didn't have like a year of runway saved up, for example. And then that was like what really like hit me. And I was like I don't want to have to make decisions based off of finances. And that's really what clicked for me.
Right on, brother. My actual real brother, my blood brother, talks about having that emergency fund a lot too. I mean, he's got like a whole budgeting system, and everything that he does is like a masterclass. You said something that made me think of him, because I think he says like 6 months or 3 months or something like that. You were talking like a year's worth of runway, you know, and I don't even know if there's many Americans that even have that 3 months worth of expenses stored away, you know, and I'm even talking, dude, like pre-COVID, you know, when everything was good for the most part. I don't think many even have that 3 months saved up to where something could happen that way. You know, so that's an interesting perspective you're talking about. You're talking about going out a year, and that's what was like your goal, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And I think the big thing is, so like anybody my age, I think I'm 33. I'm either 33 or 34, one of those.
What do you want to be today? You
know, yeah, don't go 33. That sounds better.
Perfect. I figured you'd choose that one. Yeah.
So, I mean, most of the people my age, like, so when I graduated college, it was 2010 and we were coming out of recession. So like, ever since I've been able to make real money, like things have been golden, right? So I was never worried about like, if I lost my job, like would I be able to get something else? Like the economy has been like on a steady uptick the past 10 years. So like people my age have never really had to worry about anything like this. It's just always been like, I don't need savings because like things look, the horizon looks good from here. So I think, but this is a real wake up call for a bunch of people right now.
Yeah, no joke. And I was, it was an article, I think it was in Forbes a little bit ago, and they were talking about this millennial couple in New York. And again, this was pre-COVID, man. And they were saying, you know, they make like 175K a year together or something like that. No kids, you know, and they were even saying that they don't feel rich. They don't feel well off even making $175,000 a year combined. Yeah, and just because of rent and everything else, but then the other choices that they made. I mean, they're living in New York, of course, so they have to drive some nice cars in order to have the jobs that they have and everything. And they just still didn't feel ahead making that kind of income, you know. And I compare that to like the Small Business Administration that says that the average small business owner takes home $59,000 a year. I spoke about that at Harvard just a year and a half ago too, and that stat blew my mind. So here you have 59K from a small business owner. You have a millennial couple, according to Forbes, that is making 175K a year, and they still don't even feel ahead. And you're talking that this 12 months runway. So when you said you made a phrase, right? I heard what you said when you said, before I started making real money, what is real money?
I think real money is anything, you know, out of that. I don't want to like say anything that would offend anybody that's working these kind of jobs.
Well, it's
like
perspective, right? It's subjective. Yeah.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. So like when I was in college, I was working in like a shoe store, right? And I was making like, I don't know, like $8 an hour or something like that. Like it was enough to like help me buy food while I was in college. But then like, as soon as I started getting a paycheck, and the funny thing is like, in the agency that I run now, we've got freelancers living in Serbia making more than I was making in my first job out of college in the US. Like that one little thing right there just blows my mind how fast, this is kind of getting on a tangent, but how fast like the world's shifting and how you can use location arbitrage to really like grow a business with really high skilled people. But, you know, to your question, yeah, just making like a nice paycheck, couple thousand bucks a month was just like, I was like, oh man, like I made it. Like this is it.
Like you got this millennial couple though. It's like, what's 175K a year, you know? Cause that's like what, 15 grand a month, something like that, you know, maybe 16,000 a month. And they're thinking, oh, this still doesn't do it, you know? But I understand that too, you know? Cause I mean, I've got a family with three kids and, you know, stuff costs real money. You know, if I could even use that phrase too, real money. You know, so you look at, it's a lot of times people look at, especially this past year, you know, with how the economy just kind of tanked. It's like, oh, what am I going to do? Well, I have to go into debt to pay off my expenses, you know, or to cover things for now. You know, and I've never looked at things from the perspective of, you know, I can't afford this. I always ask the question, how can I afford this? You know, and even when I'm working with, I remember in sales calls with vendors, I'm like, they would take me to that next level in business and they'll throw it back out there and they're like, well, do you have a budget? And I'm like, I've never done something with somebody who does what you do before, but it sounds fantastic and I don't really have a budget, but even if you threw a number back at me, I'd be like, you know what? I'll be right back in 2 days. I'll go sell something. And then I'll be able to afford this. So it's like the, how can I afford this mentality is something I've always lived by. So this trip to Kenya, man, you said it changed it all, right? And you had to face that elephant in the room. How did things change for you? And what did this trip do for you?
Yeah. So like when I hit the ground, when I hit the tarmac coming back to Atlanta, I was immediate, like I had no concept of business. Like I didn't, like you kind of said in the beginning, like I didn't know anything about being an entrepreneur. Like in hindsight, yeah, I grew up knowing people that own their own business, but I never heard them referred to as entrepreneurs, or like, I just thought they just had a job and they just ran things at their job, you know? Like it never connected the dots.
Well, that's true too, you know, not to cut you off, but there's a difference between an entrepreneur and a business owner. There's a lot of business owners. I don't know if there's a lot of true entrepreneurs.
Yeah. And you know, just to hit on that, somebody said something to me, it's probably been 2 months ago now. They said, a lot of people aren't business owners. They just own a lot of stock in the company they work at.
Wow.
And I was like, oh man, like that is so true.
Yeah. Yeah. Almost like just like an owner operator or something like that. Yeah. Wow. Yep. All right. So you hit the tarmac. Yeah.
Yeah. So I hit the tarmac and I got home and I really just approached it very like matter of fact, right? So like what are my, getting out of debt is on the surface so simple. Like it's A minus B, right? Expenses. You just have to reduce expenses and raise your income.
It's like a deficit diet, right? It's the
same. Yeah. Exactly, right? Yeah. Just like take your calories down, right? Your expenses and figure out how to eat more of something else, right? Make more money. So I had like had a little sports car. I had a new 370Z. I got rid of that, sold that, got a used Honda Civic. Just started like really looking at where my money was going and saying like, the only reason I drive a sports car is because I want people to think I'm cool. But do I really care if people think I'm cool? Not at all. Like, it's not going to change anything about my life if I drive past somebody going down the road and they're like, oh, that's a cool looking car. Like, so I really just started like evaluating these things. And so I got rid of everything that I consider like non-essential. Like, that's when I got rid of cable and like a bunch of stuff like that, that were just like expenses that didn't add any true value to my life. I was able to like really start to expedite things. Like then I started like doing the math and I was like, okay, like now that my expenses are lower, like here's how fast I can pay off this debt. I'm a very visual person. So I put everything in a spreadsheet and I started crunching the numbers. And like, once you know how much debt you have and you know how much money you make, you can easily figure out how long it's going to take you to pay off that debt. It's very simple. I hated that number. That number was not I don't remember exactly what it was, but it was way too many years into the future that it would take me to pay that off.
Just to clarify for everyone listening, you were probably taking your current level of income, right? And comparing that to your existing debt that you have, not making more money, but looking at your current level of income.
Yep. And so I was still in the mindset at this point of, I was not in the producer mindset. I was just in the mindset of like, let's reduce my expenses. And then like, that'll help me out. And then the producer mindset had to kick in and say, okay, this is way more years than I want to hang around here paying off this debt. Like, how can I speed that process up? So that's when I started listening to podcasts. I can honestly remember the first podcast I listened to, at least in like the business context. I was with my friend. We were going to do a juice fast, the first juice fast I ever did. So we were going to the store and he put on Pat Flynn, Smart Passive Income. I think this is a gateway for a lot of people. And I listened to that and I was like, oh man, this dude had like this crazy online business. This is pretty cool. So then I just started getting into it. Tried a bunch of different stuff that didn't work. Spent far too long trying to build a website that I hope people don't waste as much time as I did just trying to build a website. So I just did all these things. And eventually, you know, I started trying to figure out what was going to work for me. Launched a Kickstarter, raised a little bit of money on Kickstarter for a project. And yeah, just did a bunch of stuff until I stumbled into my agency now.
That's awesome, man. So when you went into that producer mindset, is that really what helped you pay off your debt?
Oh, for sure.
Yeah. So
drastically expedited.
Because I mean, you can throw numbers out there if you want to, but what level of income were you at when you said, hey, I need to address my debt scenario?
Yeah. So when I made that decision, and this is it'll dovetail into a good point as well. So when I made that decision, I was probably about 60K a year. When I went into the producer mindset, it helped me in two areas. Not only did it help me create these side businesses that were going to make some more money, it also helped me in my day job because I went into it with the mindset that I want to be working on these things on the side that are going to generate additional income. But like my day job is what's putting food on the table now. And I need to make sure I like kick ass in this thing. And through that process, by the time I left that job, I was making like 110 a year. And that was in like a 2-year period. So I got like 4 promotions during that period from just like kicking ass and taking names and doing this stuff.
So dude, yeah. So you were at 60K a year and you're thinking this is perfect because there's a lot of people that are listening that I know they're like, you know, this show is popular because it's entrepreneur based, right? And there's this dream and there's this like mystical thing about being an entrepreneur, you know, and a lot of the grit and hustle and really the fact that you don't have the safety net is the part that sucks about it sometimes. You know, so there's individuals that find out maybe that's not for me, but as a W-2 employee, you can still kick some ass.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. It's amazing. So you went from 60K a year to 110K a year. So pretty much doubling your income in like 2 years as an employee.
Yep.
That's badass.
Yeah, it's possible.
Yeah.
So like one tip for anybody that, you know, is still working a day job, the thing that I found that really, the mindset I had to be in was, my job was to make my boss look good. And so that was one part.
Dude, I need a mic drop for real. Cause you hit the nail on the head right there. Yeah. Say that again, because that is like your single job as an employee, right?
Yeah. Yeah. It's to make your boss look good.
Right on.
Yep. So, and then the second part of that was anytime something came up, like any type of new project or anything like that, even if they weren't asking me to raise my hand, I was like, hey, over here, like, can I help? Can I do this? So I was doing my best to get in front of all the big wigs in the organization. So anytime a project came up, I was doing my damnedest to like get my foot in the door, and it worked, man. I developed relationships with all the VPs in the company. And this is like there's like 30,000 people in this company. So it's a big company. Like every week I'm meeting with like the VP of our supply chain division and started developing some really good relationships. And guess what happened when these opportunities came up? Like they knew me, they knew I performed. Dude, I'm not that smart at all, but I will outwork anybody. So that, and that's what they like. Cause like most, especially in the corporate world, things are so systematized in a business at scale. You don't need a genius. You need somebody that can work hard. So like, if you can demonstrate that to your leadership, dude, you're going to go off like a rocket ship.
Right on. There is a reciprocation factor to that too, you know, cause it's, but it should always be initiated by the employee, you know, cause you should never take a job as a W-2 person and be like, hey, what's this place going to do for me? You know, especially if you're like entry level or something like that, you've got to say, hey, this is my give. This is what I'm bringing to you. And then reciprocating, you know, the good leadership will be like, hey, I value you. And I'm going to show you with my actions that I value you. I'm going to give you a promotion. You know what? Now I'm going to give you responsibility over these other divisions, you know, these other projects that we're working on too, because you have shown your value and I value you. You know, it's an awesome symbiotic relationship. And dude, I love your mindset in this too, because you can be a producer working for somebody else.
Yep. Entrepreneur.
Entrepreneur. I love, dude, I never heard that. That's awesome. Yep. That's, you didn't coin that, did you?
Cause maybe no,
you
didn't, no. Dude, there's an entrepreneur. Never heard that. And there's
that's
an entrepreneur.
That's awesome. Dude, yeah. That's incredible.
A lot of people will make far more money than they would ever make being an entrepreneur as an entrepreneur.
Yeah. Yeah. So let's talk about how you paid that debt off. Cause I mean, you reduced your expenses, right? You know, what was the shift in that? Because you said originally you're like, whoa, that was way too many years making 60K a year. Now within 2 years, you're at 110K a year. You know, how did that number shrink and how long did it take you to pay off all your debt? And what did you do specifically at that point? Was there other methods besides just reducing your expenses?
Yeah, it was 27 months in total from the point.
Yeah.
Yeah. The point I said, like, let's do this. Like, I'm going all in till the point that I paid it off. And just to be clear, like, I didn't live off rice and beans. Like, I still, like, went out. I still traveled, like, you know, went overseas a couple times during that period. Like, I was still living life, but I was doing it in a much more, like, controlled fashion.
Yeah.
If that makes
Oh, no doubt, dude. When I was dropping weight, man, I mean, it's still maintaining weight, you know, working out four times a week. It's the same principle that we're tying it back to. I just had a cookie at lunch today. same principle, because it's just, you still do the things that you enjoy. You don't have to cut out everything you love in order to succeed.
Yeah. Yeah. It's the whole 80-20 thing, right? As long as you 80% of the time you're doing what you're supposed to be doing, like, doesn't matter if you get it wrong the other 20%, you're still going to win.
No doubt. No doubt, man. So did you pay off every dollar or were you able to negotiate some of these things down too?
Yeah. So I paid off everything. So at the moment that was, so I still had, I had a little small studio condo that I was living in. I paid that off. I paid off the car, all the credit cards, student loans, everything in that time period. It was done. And what got me to like the last 50K left, like, when I had 50K left, that's when my business, that's when I finally figured this thing out after about a year of like trying a bunch of stuff, like finally found something that started making some money. And I quickly made, like our business did about, from the time we started, it did about 100,000 in about 5 or 6 months. So then after taxes and all that kind of stuff, it left me with about 30, 35K for me. And so I was easily able to knock out that last chunk. And I had a target of November of that year and I paid it off in like June of that year with the help of that.
That's awesome.
That extra money.
I'm curious on your perspective on this from somebody who's gone through this scenario. What debt did you pay off first and why? What approach did you take?
Yeah, good question. I started just, the entry point for me was Dave Ramsey. So like now, like in hindsight, I think there's some flaws in his perspective and things, but it was really good for me to start, right?
Yeah.
It was a good starting place. So I just started with credit cards because that's what he talked about. Like start with the highest rate of interest first. So I knocked that out. Then I knocked out my car. Then I knocked out my student loans. Then I knocked out my mortgage.
Yeah.
So that was the order.
It's interesting because there's two schools. You're right, because Dave is a good starting point, you know, and there's some things that he has that are great, but then there's some things that, especially when you get into the business mindset of things, that they just don't work because it's just for general consumers for the most part. But I know he talks about paying off your highest interest stuff first. And I think that's good in some scenarios. And this is what for people that are listening to, take a look at this, because if you have, let's say $25,000 on a car, right, that's at 5% interest and you have $25,000 in a credit card that's, you know, 25% interest. the reason why credit cards keep you trapped so long is because they make you pay like just like a dollar or two above what like an interest only loan is. And that's why it takes, you know, like 17 years to pay a card off if you only pay the minimum.
Funny. So it's all, I had the same thing happen to me, but with student loans. So I mentioned that like my head was in the sand for all these years when it came to my finances. So all this, I kind of had this like come to Jesus, right, moment. And I guess it was like 2017 or something. I can't remember exactly now, whenever I did this trip. So when I looked at my finances and I opened up my student loans, I realized I owed $800 more than when I graduated college. And I've been paying on it for like 7 years. So what they set me, the payment plan they set me up with coming out of college, because like they were like, hey, here's how much you owe every month. So I was like, cool. It wasn't even covering the interest. I was like, what? Yeah. How do I owe more money when I've got a school?
Yeah. And those, I mean, cards too, credit cards, they're variable in their rates, you know, because they take it off of like whatever prime plus whatever percentage they're tacking on too. So they can change over time too. So that it's crazy. Cause the other school of thought is in that same scenario with 25,000 car versus 25,000 credit card, is if they're both that dollar amount, but you can actually, but your car payment is like $500 a month or $600 a month, whatever, you pay that 25K off first, like with a bonus you get or something like that. Now you have more cash flow. You have more cash every single month to do something with, and then you can knock out that credit card faster. That works a lot like if you get a bonus or something like that, you know, from your job, your W-2, or if you're a producer, if you're an entrepreneur and you close a big deal, you know, if you have the ability to pay off that larger one that has the larger payment first, when it's like dollar for dollar, almost the same balance, then you can knock out the other one even faster. It's pretty awesome.
Yeah. And one of the things I realized through the whole process was because I considered myself to be very financially illiterate just because I didn't want to pay attention to it. Now, one of the things that I realized when I talk about, you know, now I see some flaws in the way like Dave Ramsey promotes things. It's really around debt and how you look at debt. That's one of the biggest things probably in the past 2 years that's changed in how I approach things. And I used to think like, that's why I paid off my mortgage. I was like, debt is the enemy. Like, get rid of it. Like, it's gone. It shouldn't be here. Like, I want to pay everything cash. And now I realize that there's some value in debt to do certain things, especially in the real estate world I'm getting into now.
Those are appreciating assets versus depreciating assets. Yeah. So your money can make money. That's the fantastic part in that. Yeah, man. So you 27 months, you paid off your debt. What'd you do after that?
So it's funny. It's like one of those moments that you get to and you're like, huh.
Yeah, right, exactly. That's what I'm saying. Like, I'm going to go buy something now. No, I'm kidding.
Yeah, but no, I didn't. And, you know, I made one really big mistake that it took me about 8 months to a year to realize the mistake I made. I had no goal after that. Like, that was my goal for so long. I didn't plan the next goal after that when I was approaching that one. So I just like, I floundered around for a year. Like I didn't like buy anything extravagant or anything, but I wasn't like doing anything smart with my money. Like it was just, I was just kind of living at that point. I was like, oh, I did what I came to do. And, but if I would have had like the next step already planned out, it would have been so much more efficient.
Nice. So what was that next step for you? When you took it?
Time, it was nothing, but yeah, eventually. So I got into, I rented my condo, paid off my condo. We moved out. I rent that out. So that cash flows now. I get about $600 a month off of that from just cash flow. Now I'm getting into other rental real estate. So that's, I'm just trying to really focus, put all my extra income into acquiring rental properties.
That's cool. Yeah. I mean, they're really like passive assets at that point. It's fantastic. You know, I mean, there's no true thing, I don't believe, you know, and the people can challenge me on this, whatever, but I don't think there's any true thing as like 100% passive income, because there's still thoughts and energy you put in those properties, man.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. And like my first experience was the first week my first tenant moved in, he somehow like ripped the shower handle off the wall. and so like, no, it's definitely not passive at all.
Is there, no. Yeah, it's like, is there anything truly passive? No.
even with a property management company. So I pay them, but they still call me and like, hey, this dude says that the water's running and the toilet's filling up and water shooting out of the wall. I'm like, oh, shit. Definitely not
call the plumber. That's what I'm paying you to do, is field that call and make a decision for me. Come on.
But I think it's definitely a strategy that you start to reap the benefits at scale.
Right on. No doubt that you got into podcasting now too. You're pretty fantastic with that.
So I did that for one specific reason. So I told you I spent like this year trying to figure out what the hell I was going to do. Then after I launched this Kickstarter project, I raised like $13,000 off of that. But I realized like if I calculated the hours that I put into that, I like probably made like negative money.
The Kickstarter,
I was like, there's got to be a better way to do this. Like, because I wasn't business savvy and maybe I'm not now still, but who knows. But I was like, there's got to be a better way to do this. And I was like, okay, this isn't a repeatable business. I can't keep launching Kickstarter projects. So like, this isn't a business. This was like a one hit wonder type of thing. So what am I going to do? So I started a podcast just to like interview people and start to like pick their brain. And then after about 100 interviews, I figured out something to do. It took me a long time. So, but eventually I figured it out and then stumbled across my business partner who I found. He interviewed me. So podcast connected us there. And then I've got another software product that I'm working on. He was one of the guests on my podcast. So like, and now our agency is focused. We do content marketing, but it's focused on podcasts. So like the whole thing came circle just for me, like starting a podcast to figure out what the heck I wanted to do.
That's awesome. There was somebody else that I knew that was doing that too. And he's like, I wasn't an expert in anything. Then I started 35 different podcasts. Now I know something about 35 different industries. And he would just bring on experts that way. But what is that? I mean, that's just networking, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's just talking to people, man. Forming relationships. I love that. So it's legacypodcasting.com, right? Which is a school to teach you how to podcast successfully.
Yeah, we have digital products. Yeah, and then we do our main revenue source is done for you services. So we do done for you content marketing. We lead with podcasting as kind of like the hook that gets people's attention, but we do full service content marketing.
That's awesome, man. So how did this change your life, you know, diving into this thing? You said you found your business partner, but, you know, starting the podcast, where was that shifting point for you and what did it do for you?
Yeah, I think really how it changed is I got to the point where I was waiting for Starbucks to open at 5 a.m. in the morning so I could be there when the doors open so I could work for like 2 hours before I went into the office. Then I would go to the same Starbucks on my lunch break. Then I would go to the same Starbucks when I got off of work. And eventually it got to the point where it was every day, all day, the weekends. And, you know, at this point I was engaged and it just got to be where I had to make a decision. Like, do I want to chase this dream of building this business and see if we can grow this thing? Or do I want to go the safe route, which is continue with this company I've been with for the past 5 years, which I'm growing in. And I chose the route of starting a business for some reasons. One, the potential upside of more revenue, right? A lot more than I could make in that job. The other was I wanted the challenge, right? I wanted to really like push myself outside of my comfort zone and see like, what did it take to actually start a business? And just a quick tip, it is the fastest way to personally develop yourself that you could ever run into. Like I think it should be a requirement for everybody to start a business for some period of time, because the experience you get, you will never get in the corporate world. You just won't be privy to those types of challenges and experiences, no matter what scale you get to, because there's so much support and safety nets around you in these big organizations. But when you have your own business, everything's on you. All the big decisions are on you. You get it wrong, like there's nobody to say like, hey, Ryan, that's a horrible decision. Like,
it's just you got to deal with that yourself. Exactly. Yeah. Which is a whole nother level of accountability, man, because as well as I do, especially when you have people that are working for you, it's no longer, I mean, fine. You know, when you have when you're working for a big corporation or anybody to where you're just where you're a W-2 job, you have yourself and your family to worry about, you know, but then when you start to realize when you're you have this business, or even if you're at like a high level, maybe director or C-level of a corporation, and you can really take this on, this mentality yourself, and recognize that I'm actually responsible for the livelihoods of everybody that works for me. That's a whole different kind of pressure, man.
Yeah. And you know, it can be looked at as pressure, but for me, I was telling this to somebody probably 6 months to a year ago. It's the most fulfilling part of the experience for me.
Amen. I always say I love payroll time, man. You know, I love hitting submit on that thing.
Like the coolest thing for me, and we just had one of our team members, one of the first people that we hired, she thinks she was actually number two. We've got a team of 15 now. She was like, "Hey, I just bought a house. Just bought my first house." Another one of our team members, the other day, he lives in Kenya. He was like, "Hey, man," he's like, "I just want to say thank you because we did a profit share thing this year for the first time." And so when I gave him the bonus, he bought a new laptop. And he's like, "Hey, man, I've been needing this for like 3 years. Thank you so much." Like that kind of stuff. Like, I'm like, bro, I don't even need to get paid this month. I feel good.
That's awesome, man. That's awesome. I love how you use the podcast, too, to find what you wanted to do, you know, just to search that out. That's awesome, man. What tips would you have for somebody who's starting a podcast?
Yeah, that's a really good question. One that we get quite often. I would say definitely approach it with a niche. Unless the caveat to that is if you already have some type of built-in audience, then of course you can go a bit more broad. But I think you need to go into it knowing what you want to get out of it. That's super important because that could totally change the strategy that you move forward with. Do you want to be looked at as the expert? Do you want to use it as a lead gen source? And we have clients that do both. We have some that the whole thing for them is to nurture their existing people in their audience to either keep cultivating that relationship or get the people that are on the fence over the fence. So they use it as a mechanism to build trust. We have other people who just hop on interviews like we are right now, and their whole goal is just to get in front of people that could be prospective clients, not to pitch them, but just this is the gateway to open that relationship, right? Just a conversation. They would never be able to sit down with this C-level person for an hour otherwise. So it's just a great relationship building tool. There's tons of ways, good for affiliate marketing. I mean, I haven't made a ton, but I mean, I've probably made 5 to 10,000 just off affiliate marketing. You know, I'll bring a guest on. He'll have a product, a course or something that he's selling, and you know, I'll promote it. Like, hey, if you want it, links down in the show notes. I'll get a couple $1,000 off that. So there's a lot of ways to approach it, but you really need to understand where you're heading so that you can figure out the model that you want to approach. You need to have a niche. So for me, for example, like how I approached it was, there was a bunch of people, like awesome people like you that are interviewing entrepreneurs. I was like, I want to be in this niche as well, but they're like way ahead of me, right? They have way bigger audiences. Like, I've never interviewed anybody. So like, how can I like go in a little subset of this, right? A niche of this. So like, I went after people that were still working day jobs, but had a business that was generating more than 5,000. That was my criteria. I would only interview you if you were still working a good day job and you've had a side business generating more than 5,000. Because those were the type of people that was me, but they were just a little bit ahead of me. Like, I didn't want to talk to somebody that had been an entrepreneur for 10 years. I wanted to talk to somebody that's like kind of in the same situation I'm in, so I can figure out, like, ask them like how they're doing it. Like, how are they managing this? How are they managing their time? Like all these kind of detailed questions that come with like juggling two things.
That's a good point, man. Yeah. Cause there's almost like a disconnect, right? Because I mean, where you and I are at right now versus somebody who's just starting out, you know, they can aspire to be where we're at. Yeah, but that was you and me that were aspiring to be where we're at right now 10 years ago, you know, and trying to, I remember, dude, even that, like that $1 million glass ceiling, as it's called, you know, because in my industry with managed service providers, there's not many that break that, you know, and most are like one or two man shops, and they're maybe doing 300 to 500K a year in revenue. And it's like, I was that, you know, at that point in time, and I was there at that level for a long time. You know, out of the last 11 years that my cybersecurity company has been in business, it's only really been like the past 4, you know, so it took 7 years to get to that $1 million mark. And then it shot off past that point. You know, so it was hard to relate during those first 7 years to people that had already blasted past that.
Yeah. And for me, it was all like, I struggled for a long time with just the mindset aspect. And I would, like, when I would hear these people that were just crushing it, I'm like, man, like, what am I doing wrong?
Yeah,
like, how come it's not clicking for me?
And then you start to self-sabotage when you hear that stuff too. It's like, oh, well, I guess I'm not good enough, you know? And then subconsciously you start to do things to where, and I know I did this, right? To where I could see myself to where I was like just derailing intentionally. It's like, well, this, you know, if I haven't gotten there by this point in time, you know, like those other successful people, you know, why should I even work as hard or try as hard? I guess this is my level. And you start to have that come to fruition, man. Until, like you said, you just start to blast through that horrible fixed mindset and start to actually say, you know what, maybe I can.
And social media really amplifies that, because according to Instagram, everybody's living the life.
Oh God, yeah. Yeah. According to Instagram. Exactly. Those are the keywords for anybody listening, is according to Instagram.
Yes. Yes.
Thanks for that. That's the first time I ever ate my microphone too. Yeah, I appreciate that. That was beautiful. It gave me a good thrill.
You know, but it's not the reality though. So like we saw a stat the other day that, you know, said that our business, even at the level we're in like the top 3% of small businesses.
Yeah. Yeah.
And worldwide. I'm just like,
yeah, I'm like, how worldwide.
Is that, yeah. How is that possible? I feel like we're still like scratching the surface.
Yes. But you still feel like a startup, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. So, I mean, to me, that just really put things in perspective. Like, you have all these people like flossing on the internet that like, they're just probably in a very bad place mentally, and like this is what gets them through the day, and like I feel bad for them, like really, like I'm glad I'm at a point where I feel like I don't need to do that, like not that I've made it or anything, but I think that a lot of people do that as bridging the gap between like where they're really at and where they want to be.
Yeah, right on. I feel you. You got married in India 3 years ago, right?
Yeah.
Yeah,
you might see some pictures right here.
Yeah. Oh yeah, on your TV back there. That's awesome. I've been seeing some of that. That's pretty awesome, dude.
Yeah.
Way to go, man. What's in store for that?
Fun. Yeah, it was amazing, man. Like, I've been to a lot of weddings in the US, right? And I used to dread every one of them. I was super happy for the people I was there to see, but just like the whole process was just like a little monotonous and boring for me. And then I experienced like my wedding in India was the first one that I'd been to there. And it was just, it's so over the top, man. It's like 3 days long, all these ceremonies, like the whole family is there and committed. Like, it's not like in the US, like your uncle's there, but he's like, Jesus, I'm ready to go home, or I'm ready for the after party so I can have a beer. But like there, like everybody was like pot committed. Everybody was like all in, the whole family. They would take off like a week of work to participate at your wedding. And it was just like mind blowing to me, the cultural difference between there and here. And it was just an absolute blast. Like, my wife is the first of her family to come to the US. She got her master's from UF, and she stayed here and somehow married a white boy. And so I had to convince them that I was okay. And then went to India and we got married.
That's awesome, dude. Congrats, man. That's so much fun. Brother, I've appreciated our conversation. I want everyone to go to Ryan Helm's site at legacypodcasting.com, especially if you're looking to start a podcast or you need some kind of amazing content marketing. Dude, thank you for coming on the show today.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
What's shaking? Thank you for joining me on the All In Podcast. Click the subscribe button and smash that bell for notifications. Text me, 312-535-8520. Follow me on social media at Mr. Rick Jordan. See you next episode. I am Rick Jordan, and I approve this message.